In the European Union, there is a kind of continuous debate, a more or less silent struggle taking place between two different concepts of Europe, the free market concept and the socialist concept. And this struggle is evident at every turn in parliamentary debates, for instance. The European Union project was actually very attractive in the beginning, and it emerged imbued with free market spirit. The idea of a European economic community was initially based on the free circulation of people, capital and goods. The great founders of the European project, Jean Monnet, Robert Schuman, Konrad Adenauer, envisaged that the borders between the countries of Europe would disappear, and they would become like the regions of a large area of economic liberty. Initially, this was known as a customs union, and it is where the most progress has been made, though it is not yet absolutely perfect. We have taken important steps forward in the structure of Europe. For example, the euro has been introduced as the single European currency, and in a way, it constitutes an approximation, even if only a timid one, to the ideal of the single world currency that gold once was. But the monetary policy of the European Central Bank has left much to be desired. To give you an idea, the Maastricht Treaty set an objective of no more than 4.5% growth in the M3 money supply. However, for many years in the past, the European Central Bank allowed the money supply to grow by over 7%. Furthermore, the distribution of monetary growth is never uniform among all the countries in the European Union, just as it is never uniform among the different states in the United States. Instead, growth was double in the periphery countries, who are now referred to as pigs. We have already studied the resulting credit expansion, which involved the granting, at extremely low interest rates, of loans unbacked by real saving. The entire European Union was affected, but especially these countries. Massive investment errors occurred, and it became clear that the related projects were unviable, and that explains both the financial crisis and the profound economic recession we have suffered. I repeat, the cause has been the grave errors in monetary policy committed by the European Central Bank. Even so, we must acknowledge that though these errors were grave, they were much less grave than the ones committed by the American counterpart, the US Federal Reserve. The other Achilles heel of the European Union is the tremendous interventionism it stages, particularly in certain areas, for instance, that of the Common Agricultural Policy. The Common Agricultural Policy goes back to the founding of the European Union. It has the largest budget in the Union, and it completely distorts the allocation of resources. We saw that guaranteed prices and subsidies on agricultural products harm consumers, who must pay more than they would have had to pay under different circumstances. They harm every EU citizen, who must pay higher taxes in order to finance the whole subsidy system. And they harm third world countries when international markets are flooded with surplus European agricultural products which are exported at the expense primarily of those countries that can sell only that type of product, namely poor third world countries. No one benefits because economic agents adapt to subsidies and they are a dead end like drugs. It is very hard to get off drugs. Well, it is also very hard to give up intervention. As soon as we get used to a subsidy, it is politically inconceivable to eliminate the error in economic policy. Privileged interest groups fill the streets with tractors and bring the country to a standstill. No one dares to confront those who are supposedly favored by a subsidy. So, as I have said, there is a struggle between two completely different views of the European Union. One is the so-called protectionist and socialist view of Europe, which aims to turn Europe into a sort of protectionist fortress toward the outside world. In other words, tariff barriers would be created against goods and services from economic areas outside of Europe, while it would be profoundly interventionist on the inside. Here, the logic of European interventionists is very clear. Since no country can, in isolation, impose its interventionist measures, its supposed social policies, to provide worker protection and so on, without ceasing to be competitive and losing investments to other European countries, the only solution is to turn to Brussels and request that such measures be imposed compulsorily on all of the countries. And this creates some tension, because some nations are opposed to it, such as the UK and the new member countries from Eastern Europe, which have a much more free market spirit. Well, the centralism of Brussels is basically of French origin, though it often receives certain support from Germany as well. Germany has a highly developed welfare state, and it is in the country's interest to remain competitive and avoid any so-called unfair competition from other poorer countries, like perhaps Spain. There is an insistence on imposing such interventionist measures on all of the countries, to the detriment of those which are relatively less productive, and which, with such a generous welfare state, would be totally unable to compete with the rest of the European nations. So, the self-interest of certain countries leads them to demand these interventionist measures, which are also very vigorously supported by an army of thousands of European civil servants, the so-called Eurocrats, along with public opinion, which is, as always, manipulated, and asks, who is going to be against the European social space, and against all European workers receiving the same high degree of protection German workers receive? However, I repeat, it is a poisoned gift, because for Greeks, Italians, and Spanish people, that protection would come at a cost that would render their countries uncompetitive. We are less productive than the Germans, and we cannot compete with them unless our production processes are less costly. If by law a production cost as high as in Germany is imposed on us, we are eliminated from among the competition. Still, I must note that despite the comments I have made about the grave errors in monetary policy committed by the European Central Bank, entrance into the monetary union, that is, the euro, has been a divine blessing for the periphery countries. For the first time in history, these countries have lost their monetary autonomy or sovereignty, and now, for the first time, it is perfectly obvious that they need to tackle the problems facing them and make the necessary structural reforms. To put it another way, until Greece entered the European Union, all of the demagogic madness of Greek politicians came at no cost to Greece, because the moment the country lost its competitiveness, precisely by lowering the retirement age to 60, hiring more civil servants than any other country, guaranteeing that Papa State would take care of everything, the moment Greece lost its competitiveness, the negative effects to citizens were concealed simply by depreciating the drachma and causing inflation. So, from one day to the next, if the drachma was depreciated by 15 or 20%, just as the peseta was devalued in Spain by 20% or more in the three devaluations Solchaga brought about before Spain entered the European Union, then that meant that citizens lost 20% of their wealth and income overnight. But when this happens, people do not notice it. There is a money illusion, and people peacefully go about their business. Later, they gradually experience the effects in the diluted form of rising prices and so on. It is like when someone with a hangover is given another dose of alcohol, feels better temporarily, and goes on drinking. The result is that with the autonomous monetary policy we had, Greece with the drachma and Spain with the peseta, there was no incentive to face up to underlying problems. There was no transparency. Citizens were unaware of what was going on, and there was no discipline to limit the demagogy of the authorities. Fortunately, this is no longer the case today. Since we are in the Eurozone, we can no longer depreciate or devalue our currency. Furthermore, if we spend more than we take in, we have to return it, and that means we must go into debt, and those who lend us money internationally study our accounts with extreme care, and they can see if our politicians are actually demagogues and are promising what they cannot pay for, and citizens are living in a kind of illusory nirvana. This is what leads to crises like the Greek crisis, and thank heavens Greece has the euro, because for the first time in the history of Greece, the country is obliged to undertake the reforms necessary to put its economy back on a sound footing. These reforms mean lowering prices, some more than others, to the point where they become competitive again. and reducing public spending, especially the salaries of civil servants. Do you think that in a poor country, everyone can retire at the age of 60? Do you think that is sustainable, when in Germany, a much richer country, people retire at the age of 67? In general, all of the demagogic policies which politicians promote by deceiving citizens in order to stay in power have now ceased to be possible, and Greece is obliged to face up to reality, because if it does not, it will be expelled from the European Union and will become a third world country or a banana republic. For the first time, Greek citizens realize that they have lived in an illusion and that they have no choice but to tighten their belts to get out of the predicament they are in. They realize that public spending must be reduced, that the promises of the welfare state cannot be fulfilled, that the economy must be very flexible and productive, and that the labor market must be very free if the country is to recover competitiveness and be able to export and sell products abroad. Greece is taking the necessary measures, something it would never have done had it been able to resort to inflation, devaluation, and depreciation, as it has traditionally done. Everything I have said about Greece is applicable, mutatis mutandis, to Ireland, Italy, Portugal, and Spain, aside from the slight differences of degree that may exist between the different countries. We should be truly grateful for the euro, because for the first time, our politicians have been exposed. They are between a rock and a hard place, and they have no choice but to take the bull by the horns, tell citizens the truth, confront the problems, and undertake the necessary structural reforms. Hopefully, the free market view of the European Union will always prevail over the outwardly protectionist and inwardly interventionist view. For the periphery countries like Spain, entrance into the European Union has undoubtedly let in the fresh air of greater relative liberty in the economy, and, currently, in competitive opportunities. Moreover, entrance into the Eurozone has brought greater transparency and discipline, particularly with regard to the demagogy of politicians and the vicious vote-buying cycle of democracy, in which politicians promise what they cannot pay for.